Okay, I'd like to call to order the March 7th, 2023 Planning Commission meeting. We do roll call.
Austin.
Here.
Cardio.
Here.
Cloud.
Here.
Compton.
Here.
Couch.
Here.
Hussein.
Here.
Mueller.
Here.
Parker.
Here.
Tyler.
Here.
And approval of the minutes from February 7th, 2023. Do I have a motion for approval?
You do, Shannon. I'd move that we approve the minutes as presented.
Okay. Motion by Dr. Second. Compton, second by Mr. Cloud. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? We do have a tabled item. If you are here for that item, it's RP23-03, North Heights Edition. That is going to be tabled. Okay, the first item on the agenda is RP23-01, Black Oak Plaza in Chester Heights, presented by Expedient Civil Engineering.
Hello, I'm Avery Bodine, representing Expedient Civil Engineering, here to present this project. I know we are doing a replat, a lot combination.
Can you get a little closer to, because you're
Can you hear me? Is that better?
That's okay. Yes.
Hello, I'm Avery Bodine. I'm here representing Expedient Civil Engineering on the Black Oak Plaza in Chester Heights, requesting approval of a lot combination of lots 4 and 5.
Okay, do we have staff comments?
Staff has only standard comments at this time.
And that's just on the replat. We have a large scale with variances we'll get to once the replat is completed, okay? Do we have any engineering comments? Okay. So we need a motion and a second to approve the replat.
A motion.
Motion by Mr. Cloud and motion by second by Mr. Hussein. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
I think those have roll call votes.
Oh, those I'm sorry.
The only thing that's everybody in favor, everything else is a roll call vote.
Okay.
I like the
sorry.
Yep.
Austin.
Yes.
Cardio.
Yes.
Cloud.
Yes.
Compton.
Yes.
Couch.
Yes.
Hussein.
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Okay, that passes.
If you want that to go to council next Tuesday evening, the ordinance needs to be in our office by noon tomorrow.
Ordinance in yes. Your office tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We're good, too.
The next is the large-scale development on this same property. You want to tell us a little bit about it?
Yes, we're...
Back to the microphone.
Let me swing it over here a little bit. So this is a large-scale development for doing a couple things. We're doing a proposed building that covers 9,400 square foot. And basically we're adding parking out in the front. This is already kind of has a shared parking access along there, and we're just using that existing drive and tying into that driveway. Do you want me to go over the variance request as well at this time?
Might as well.
Okay, so we have a variance request for the facades and exterior walls, roof, and materials and colors. Now, those cover we only have the north elevation that we're asking these variances for. The main purpose is that behind there are fences and a tree line that hinder the view from the adjacent property to the north. So,
what's the percentage of materials of the entire building?
Do not have that number on me currently.
Okay. And then.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Landscaping variance too.
The landscape buffer around the building could not be met due to the fact of all the utilities on the north side of the property. that we were describing, there's a fiber optic line, there's storm sewer going through there. It's just a utility easement, more or less, and we weren't able to get the landscape buffer in the front as well as the landscape perimeter around the building due to that, the size of the building and with the all the utilities in the rear of the lot.
But technically, a smaller building, you could get some of that in.
Technically, yes, ma'am.
Okay. Staff comments?
In addition to standard comments, we have foundation landscaping is required, for which a variance has been requested. Roof line shall be varied with a change in height every 100 linear feet, and building length, for which a variance has been requested. And predominant exterior building materials shall not be smooth-faced concrete block, tilt-up concrete panels, or prefab steel panels. Variance has been requested.
Engineering comments. If parking stalls are located adjacent to a sidewalk of 5 feet wide or less, add parking stops to the stalls. This allows full width of the sidewalk to be utilized by pedestrians. For the street lights, please include a note that specifies that any installation costs are by owner and that the utility company will specify the light type, utility usage costs billed to the city. Truncated domes are required at all ramps. I think it's just the south side of that crosswalk.
Yeah, the volume needs to be turned up. Yeah. Everybody's hard to hear.
Is that better?
That's better.
Okay.
Katie, and this has detention under the parking lot, correct?
Yes, this has underground detention connecting to existing storm sewer.
Okay. Is this to the commission? Does the commission have any?
Can you go back to the site plan, whoever's charging? Landscape, that one. Does the landscape plan, sorry. Perfect. Is that reflective of what the landscape's going to look like? Or no?
Yes.
Did I? Sorry.
Just so the fire department wanted to make sure that everyone's aware, especially the design team. This area, they need about 1,750 GPM to build this building, fire flow. And the hydrant to the north, shows it greater than 1,500, but the hydrant to the south shows it somewhere between 1,000 and 1,500 GPM. We need a fire flow test before this can be signed off by planning and engineering and us, so we know there's sufficient fire flow. We're concerned there isn't sufficient fire flow for the size of building that's being built.
And is that something that you think it needs to be done before we move forward with this?
Because no, we're more than happy to move forward with it now. We just got to have those figures, and we want to, you know, warn, don't order the steel yet, because if you can't build the building, you're in trouble.
Okay, so if it doesn't work, they'd have to come back with a smaller building.
Or sprinkler it.
Okay. Okay, the calculations on the landscaping. So if the foundation landscaping is waived, do you have enough additional landscaping on the site to provide what would have normally been done if you'd done all of it?
Yeah. We calculated the square footage proposed around the building. I'm almost 100% positive we could apply that additional square footage of landscaping and amount of trees and shrubs required, or amount of shrubs required around that.
Okay, building. And so as Mr. Cloud asked, the landscaping plan that's on here,
yes,
we're looking at tonight, meets all those requirements.
Landscaping plan meets all those requirements.
Okay.
In their letter, they stated that they had enough room to place that around the site, even though they didn't have enough room around the building. Okay. Foundation, they put in the letter that they could do it.
We just want to make sure the plan has it where it,
yeah.
I can add that percentage to the plans and show them to you at a later, yeah. As far as what's required around the building and also what we'll plant as far as to make up for that.
Okay. Hey, we can take these all together. This is a call for the vote. Or
sure. Are they all good?
Sure.
Okay, call for the vote.
Call for the vote.
Is that by Mr. Parker? Mr. Parker.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
Passes.
We need a motion and a second for the approval of a large-scale subject to staff comments.
Do we have a motion?
So motion.
Motion by Mr. Cloud. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Cardiel.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardiel?
Yes.
And that passes. Move on to the next one. Next, we have L2271, Springdale's Best Storage, presented by Bates and Associates.
Jeff Bates with Bates and Associates. I can help answer any site questions or the landscape variants, and also have the architect here to help explain some of the commercial design standard variances.
Okay. Do we have staff comments?
In addition to standard comments, we have foundation landscaping is required, for which a variance has been requested. Facades over 100 feet in linear length shall incorporate wall projections and or recesses per Springdale commercial design standard, for which a variance has been requested. Roof lines shall be varied with a change in height at least every 100 linear feet. In building length, variance has been requested. Predominant exterior building materials shall be high quality materials, including without limitation the following: brick, native natural stone, synthetic stone, concrete masonry units or smooth face units with integral color, synthetic stucco ephes, architectural precast concrete, decorative face concrete, tilt up panels, glass wood, natural or composite, for which a variance has been requested.
Engineering comments. The finished floor elevations do not look correct compared to the site elevations. See sheet 5 on the grading plan. And a short-term activity authorization may be required to work in Spring Creek. Please verify with ADEQ and submit to the city if necessary. Add note to the site plan about stockpiling of construction spoil material. Any parking spaces that are adjacent to a sidewalk that is 5 feet or less, please provide parking stops for those spaces and update the commercial drive detail to the 2018 version. Street lights, please show the direction of the mast arm, show the size and type of the lights based on the location and classification of the street. Include a note stating if the lights are public or private and who will be responsible for maintenance and billing. The rest is standard comments.
Ed, do you have comments left for billing and fire?
The four buildings on the east side have to be sprinklered, and we need to see the fire lines and the FTC locations on those buildings.
Is that a problem for them to be sprinklered, Jeff?
No, we're working with Springdale Water right now. We have to relocate some mains and get the water to it to get the right flow. So that's already in the process. Landscaping, it's the foundation landscaping request is because there's storage units and there's doors in front of them. We crammed as much. I don't think we got everything that would have been required because there wasn't enough room, but we crammed as much as we could all along the perimeter to get as much landscaping in there as we could. And number C, they ended up doing all the buildings brick. So I think that addresses those two.
All the buildings are going to be brick?
Yes. All sides, all the buildings are brick. We did not do the 100 foot because of the problem with the doors and that sort of thing being interfered with. If we did recesses and projections, it would have been kind of problematic on getting things in there. But we did make everything brick. It's 100%.
Okay.
A fence and trees and shrubs.
And you are doing street improvements.
And we're doing street improvements.
Okay.
To almost the entire street.
Except we're doing it for those three houses that remained and aren't part of this project, but you're doing street improvements there and you're doing the cul-de-sac all the way around or half the cul-de-sac?
All the way around.
Okay, so we're getting the cul-de-sac at the end, street improvements on their side, all the way down through there. Street improvements along Emma Street?
Yes.
And a sidewalk?
Yes.
And your gate is back far enough from the street that you won't block Emma with a trailer sitting out in Emma Street?
Correct, they've got some stacking room in there.
Okay, and there's no one on site? This is all handled through a key system, no manager on site or anything like that?
Correct.
Okay, and all your lighting on the sides of the building is designed to shine on that piece of property, not off?
Yeah, I believe there's a photometric plan.
Okay.
Right there.
Well, it's kind of hard to see at that scale, so. So really, the only thing that you're, is the facades don't have breaks in them, but they're all brick. The roofs don't have any breaks in them, any of that. The materials and cover you're showing is all brick. And the landscaping, you've got as much landscaping on there because you have too many buildings, correct? If you had less buildings, you could get some more landscaping on there.
That's true.
Correct?
That's correct. We are relocating a lot of water lines and paving a big street.
But you know it's the property that has those opportunities.
I'm just the middleman.
As you can tell, we've had those conversations before. Yeah, okay.
Okay, do we want to take these all together?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, this is a call for the vote.
Call for the vote.
Call for the vote by Mr. Parker.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Hussein? Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardio?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Passes.
Need a motion and a second.
I need a motion and a second.
Make a motion.
Subject to staff comments.
Subject to staff comments.
Motion by Mr. Parker. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Tyler.
Can I make a brief comment real quick? Can we put in the notes that all the wall packs will be full cut off, no lighting above 90 degree, unless that's already in there. Just trying to get ahead of this.
It may not be, but I will make sure that is done.
Thank you.
We'll add that in the notes.
Sorry.
No, that's good.
I gave you the option when you asked about the lights.
Couch? Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
And that passes 9-0.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next is item B2321, Connie and Barbara Ann Bowerman, presented by Bates and Associates.
My name is Cody with Bates and Associates. We're proposing a track split located at 3219 North 56th Street. And within that proposed, we're asking for a variance to allow a shed to stay in its place that's been there for years.
It can't be moved. It's not a portable shed. It has a...
It's a permanent shed. It's a permanent shed.
Okay.
They would be able to tear it down. That's why we're asking... Let's see if we can have it stay in its place.
Ed, y'all gonna comment on it?
Lot line that it is on is existing.
Yeah, it's an existing nonconformity, so we won't have some comment on it.
Yeah. Okay, this is a call for the vote. The commission has any questions?
Call for the vote.
Call for the vote by Dr. Compton.
I got a question. This was done. The shed was there before this was in city limits?
Correct. Okay. Shed's been there for years.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
That passes 9-0. The next item is W23-07, Hugo Rodriguez Castillo and Maria Martinez, presented by Hugo Rodriguez Castillo and Maria Torres Martinez.
Do you want to come back to it? Come back to it before we close the meeting. Yeah.
Okay, we'll move on to public hearing comment. The first one is R23-08, Charlotte Incorporated, presented by Cochran Engineering.
Good evening. My name is Kurt Daniels of Cochran Engineering, number 80 Main Street, Winchfield, Missouri, for the record. What we're bringing before you is the site that you're seeing up on the screen is 2.23 acres. We're requesting that to go from A1 zoning to C2. So I'll be glad to answer any additional questions if there are any. And it's for a large scale development. It'll come back before you a little later in the meeting.
Staff, do we have staff comments?
The adopted land use plan indicates commercial use for the area. The rezoning request is in keeping with the following goals and policies. The comprehensive land use plan is recommended for approval, encourage the development of regional commercial areas that accommodate a variety of wholesale, retail, service, and office uses where the highest traffic volumes and greatest utility demands can be served, and more extensive outdoor display of materials will be expected and permitted as frontage and or access to I-49.
Do we have any comments from the audience? Comments from the commission? This is a call for the vote.
Call for the vote.
Call for the vote by Mr. Cloud.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
That passes 9-0.
Staff will prepare the ordinance that goes to council on the 28th. We'll go ahead and hear the large scale now while you're up there so you don't have to wait.
That worked.
Good evening. Once again, Kurt Daniels, Cochran Engineering, 80 Main Street, Winchfield, Missouri. What we're bringing before you tonight is a club car wash on the proposed tract we just talked about. As you can see here, the building lies in the middle of the site. This is on the 2.23 acres. This is the southern portion of the site. As you come in off the access road that will be internal to the two lots we access in on the north side, we'll come in immediately, turn for the queuing, the stacking to basically pay or do the fast pass for the car wash. They'll then continue west and south to where they enter the building. The southern portion of the building on the south side is what you see are the vacuum bays. So those are the areas that the people can elect to go in and vacuum the cars out, or they can move on and go on down the road. We do have underground detention on the left side of this plan, which will be meet the requirements. I think we've met all photometrics, landscape, and I think we have met all requirements that the city's requested from my understanding. And if there's any questions, I'd be glad to answer them.
Ron, you have any comments? We do appreciate how hard y'all work with us to get all this stuff done.
Thank you. Thank you.
Engineering, have any comments? Okay, building inspection, no, we're good.
Okay. This is a motion subject to staff comments.
Make a motion subject to staff comments.
Motion by Mr. Parker.
Second.
Second by Dr. Compton.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
I drive by this site every day because I live right down Don Tyson. I always wonder what would they put there because of the... Just how hard it is getting in and out, but it's but I really appreciate the work you and the staff have done for the landscape. I can't imagine doing a better job with that than what you guys have done.
Well,
yes.
Thank you very much. And I have to say, as our client, the owner of this, is he's very particular, so it will look nice, I'm sure. It always does.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes. passes 9-0.
So we're done for the night.
Yes.
I love the way you moved.
But you're welcome to stay and see the rest of it. We wouldn't be mind if you decide to stay.
You let people know Missouri is how we do in the spring, though.
The city we're in is now.
Next is item R23-09, Maria Guadalupe Rios Yanez, presented by Maria Guadalupe Rios Yanez.
Good evening. I'm translating for Miss Maria. My name is Lorena, and we are requesting to rezone from I-2 to a C-2. She is wanting to start a family hair salon business.
And she understands that you can't live there.
Yes.
It's just going to be the hair salon itself.
Yes, okay. Yes.
The land use plan indicates commercial use for the area. The rezoning request is in keeping with the following goals and policies. The comprehensive land use plan is recommended for approval, encourages the development of office and professional uses that provide a transition between residential areas and more intense uses with reasonable building height limitations and adequate buffering and landscaping to ensure compatibility.
Do we have any comments from the audience? Could you please go to the mic and state your name and address?
My name's Kendall Proctor. I own the meat market there at 2106. My question is, will the parking have to be paved on this building? And will there be a survey? My parking lot actually goes about 10 feet past the poles to the south. And my question is, how will the parking work with this building, given the fact that we have a lot of problems with the mechanic shops to the north of us? It's a parking nightmare. The mechanics all use our parking lot. We've had incidents with customers, you know, having problems with people that park crossways in our parking lot. So I'm just curious how the parking will be laid out for that building.
Okay, we don't normally do that with the rezoning, but she has been told she would have to provide paved parking and bring back a site plan that shows how she's going to do that and how she's going to access it.
Okay.
So we'll have a chance. It probably won't come back to Planning Commission because it's just adding parking, but you're welcome to call the office once we get that layout established. She's looking to remodel the existing structure, so we got to get into all that to see whether it can be done or not.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Do we have any other comments? Okay, this is going to be a call for the vote.
Call for the vote.
Call for the vote by Mr. Parker.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
That passes 9-0.
Staff will prepare the ordinance that goes to the council on the 28th.
Okay. Thank you. The next item is R23-10, Betty Lott, presented by Tim West with Atlas.
Tim West with Atlas Professional Land Surveying, here representing Betty Lott in the petition to rezone the property at 5238 Old Wire Road from A1 to SF1. Be glad to answer any questions that you may have.
Staff comments?
The land use plan indicates commercial use for the area. The rezoning request is in keeping with the following goals and policies of the land use plan is recommended for approval. Stabilize property values and maintain the integrity of neighborhoods by protecting residential neighborhoods from non-residential influences and providing buffers between residential and non-residential uses.
Do we have any comments from the audience? Okay, this is a call for the vote.
Call for the vote, Shannon.
Call for the vote by Dr. Compton.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker? Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
That passes 9-0.
Staff will prepare the ordinance to go to council on the 28th.
Thank you.
Next item is R23-12, Helen Garrison, presented by Hayden Gilder.
Hayden Gilder to present transfer from A1 to C5 for a property at 4500 West Seton Drive.
Staff comments?
The land use plan indicates reasonable commercial. The rezoning request is in keeping with the following goals and policies of the comprehensive land use plan is recommended for approval. Encourage the development of regional commercial areas that accommodate a variety of wholesale, retail, service, and office uses where the highest traffic volumes and greatest utility demands can be served, and more extensive outdoor display of materials will be expected and permitted that has frontage and access and/or access to I-149.
Do we have any comments from the audience? Could you go to the mic and state your name and address?
Hi, I'm Mika Bartlett. I'm at 4521 Seton Drive, so I'm just directly south and adjacent to the property. And I'm not sure if it would be here, but my questions are pertaining to the structure, because we are a dented street, is if they're keeping the existing structure, rebuild, you know, remodeling, are we dealing with traffic, flow, parking? My understanding is it's, on the letter I received, it was going to be a healthcare executive office.
Well, at this point, we're only talking about the rezoning of the property to C5. So anything that's allowed in a C5 zoning district can go into this zoning district. When they come back to build something, we will get a large scale development plan that will show us how they access it, how they take care of drainage.
Okay.
How they get water and sewer to it, what the building looks like, the lighting, and all that kind of stuff.
Okay.
This is just to set up the first stage. You'll be notified again as adjacent property owner when the large scale is filed.
Perfect. Thank you.
Any other comments? Okay, this is a call for the vote. Call for the vote of Mr. Cartier.
Cardio?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
That passes 9-0.
Staff will prepare the ordinance that goes to council on the 28th.
Thank you.
Next item is R23-13, Cornelia P. Williamson Revocable Trust, presented by Engineering Services.
Thank you, Jason Apple with ESI. This item and the next item kind of go together, they're adjacent properties. We're proposing the northern portion of this 18 acres, approximately 9 acres, to go to C6, and the southern piece, which is adjacent to the industrial park, be rezoned to I-2. And I'll answer any questions.
Staff comments?
The land use plan indicates heavy commercial use for the area. The rezoning request is in keeping with the following goals and policies. Sure, adequate land allocation for industrial growth protected from encroachment by non-industrial uses. Now, I know a C6 is not an industrial use, but it does blend better with the property to the north that's zoned commercial, as is. It's going to be the same comments for the other one, too.
Do we have any comments from the audience? This is a call for the vote.
My only question is, are we not rezoning that northwest corner, and how come we're leaving it A1?
So that portion is just kind of a remnant portion of this property that was taken whenever new 265 came through.
It split that
parcel in half, basically. And, you know, my clients are not under contract to purchase that piece of property at this time, so it's just kind of a remainder piece that just going to
It wasn't an economic remnant when the highway went through, but they chose to keep it instead of taking it as right away, so it's kind of a
Okay, so we might see some with that some other time.
It would have, it probably needs to be combined with some other property that's on that side to be usable, because it's too small to be used by.
Oh, and they probably have like an access.
There is access management on 265, so that is a problem, too.
Did I have a call for the vote?
Call for the vote?
Call for the vote by Mr. Parker.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton.
Yes.
Couch.
Yes.
Hussein.
Yes.
Mueller.
Yes.
Parker.
Yes.
Tyler.
Yes.
Austin.
Yes.
Cardiel.
Yes.
That passes 9-0.
Staff will prepare the ordinance. It goes to the council on the 28th.
And the next item, R23-14, is the same.
Same split between C6 and I2.
Do we have any comments from the audience? That would also be a call for the vote. Call for the vote by Mr. Austin.
Compton.
Yes.
Couch.
Yes.
Hussein.
Yes.
Mueller.
Yes.
Parker.
Yes.
Tyler.
Yes.
Austin.
Yes.
Cardiel.
Yes.
Cloud.
Yes.
That passes 9-0.
Staff will prepare the ordinance. It goes to council on the 28th.
Thank you.
The next item on the agenda is PP23-02, Jennifer Plaza, presented by Swope Engineering.
Phil Swope, Swope Engineering. This is a property we're just planning on a commercial subdivision. I think it's 4 or 5 lots that are planned with a single road, dead-end cul-de-sac.
Do we have staff comments?
At this time, staff only has standard comments.
Engineering comments. storm profile stationing looks incorrect. Storm manhole A5 is labeled as station 0. They just look swapped. Two storm outlet details are shown in the detail section, but elevations don't seem to match. Please clarify where these will be used. Some of these are standard comments. Update information pertaining to streets and sidewalks. Sidewalks are required on Jennifer Terrace adjacent to the development. The street section shown is too narrow for on-street parking. Please show no parking signs on both sides of the street. Update city engineering contact to Ben Peters. And I have the rest of his information on there. The rest are just standard comments.
But they have to provide profiles on the street because it goes across what used to be the landfill, correct?
Yes, so they have had, or they have added notes about that onto the plat, and then we have requested soil borings to verify how we're actually going to build that street before we go forward to construction.
And that note is also for building inspection. Before you can get a building permit, you got to know that you're building on the right site because it was part of the old landfill.
Commission, is there any questions from the audience or comments? This is a motion subject to staff comments. Motion by Mr. Tyler.
Second.
Second by Dr. Compton.
Couch.
Yes.
Hussein.
Yes.
Mueller.
Yes.
Parker.
Yes.
Tyler.
Yes.
Austin. Cardiel.
Yes.
Cloud.
Yes.
Compton.
Yes.
Passes 9-0.
Thank you.
The next item is L23-18, lots 102, holding storage, presented by Engineering Services.
Thank you, Jason Apple with ESI. This project was previously approved in September of 2022. Clients have made some revisions to the site plan. The front building was single-story at that approval, and we're requesting that building to be two-story climate control. And then there's a building on the far western side of the site that was just standard mini storage units, and we've combined that into one larger building for RV parking. And I'll answer any questions.
Do we have staff comments?
For planning, besides standard comments, the one building, not the one to the far east, but the one next to it, says minimum 3 feet of clear width excluding vehicle overhang must be provided as an accessible circulation route. Therefore, the sidewalk must either be 5 feet wide or have wheel blocks between the handicap access point and the doorway. I don't know what the measurements are for that right there. Not sure if it's a sidewalk or if it's just painted lines on the pavement there. Also, with that building, it appears that it could be used for trades and services. We've been told in comments that it will be for RV storage only. If that is true, how will RVs get there? How will they get into the building? Will they fit where overhead door is going to be? Screening fence is required in accordance with Chapter 56. Show trees associated with screen. Existing tree canopy on east side and south need the following: the number of trees that will remain, type of trees remaining, and some way of marking which trees will remain. Response to that is that ESI will not be doing a tree survey, but did add a comment that existing tree line to be reserved for perimeter landscape requirements yielding to South Springdale Water Utilities and Black Hills Energy requirements as needed. Lighting plan is required, displaying at least 1 foot candle in all parking and pedestrian areas. Lighting is still not sufficient in the area of the parking, would be the southeast corner. And we had a couple of variances passed in previous for foundation landscaping and some of the elevation issues. I believe that's it for planning.
Only engineering comment is to place an accessible surface under and adjacent to the proposed benches that connects to the sidewalk.
Jason, how do you expect us to know what your perimeter landscaping plan is going to be if the existing canopy is to be reserved and we don't know what it is? Because we've seen lots of places where you say you're going to protect it, and the next thing we know, it's all gone. So, and that's your perimeter landscape.
Yeah, my proposal is to provide a tree protection fencing there through construction so that those trees will remain.
All of them that are there now will be there, remain. They're not going to cut any of them out.
Yeah, we'll just add a tree protection perimeter on the north side of that area. Okay. And
so do we know how many trees there are and how well it meets the requirements?
I mean, there's a pretty significant buffer there if you've been by, but I've
significant.
Pretty significant.
Significant, pretty significant. It's kind of hard to qualify when we get into this. Also, these.
I mean, this building, was, like I said, this was previously approved last time. We had this discussion last time, I believe. And, well,
we're getting to this more and more where we say it's going to be existing canopy is going to be preserved. And you're asking the Planning Commission to go out there and look at it and determine whether or not that is permissible and meets the requirements when it's your responsibility to tell the Planning Commission that you met the requirements. So that should be noted. But the other question I have is if that building on the east side is going to be RV storage and it has, does it have the doors on the side where the parking lot, where the parking
spaces
are?
There's doors on the opposite side.
I'm sorry?
There's doors on the east side.
Okay. Did we get an elevation that shows what that looked like? I couldn't tell which building was which.
I believe it's the same as the building to the, I mean, those two buildings are very similar.
Okay. So is there one more sheet before this one? Okay. So the one that says the west elevation color, that's the one that you see from the street, right?
Yes.
And you're saying this building is going to look just like that on the other, this other building on the east side, and there will be doors on the back.
No, this elevation is the two-story climate control. It's on the west side. That faces Butterfield Cove.
Okay. So what does this building, this other building look like?
I think there was one. It's got to be that one right there. I think that's just an opposite. Let me keep going. I'm sorry.
Is Is it this one?
Yep.
That one's it, yeah.
Okay, so that's
so I think they've got this, they're swapped on the elevation, so it'd be west and east. Those elevations are swapped there. So.
Okay, it was very confusing.
It's the same building as the one directly adjacent to it, to the east.
Okay.
And I can do a tree survey. We can go out there and count trees. We'll show the trees on the plan. It's fine.
You'll show the trees on the plan?
Sure.
Okay. That helps us know what we got and what we don't
have. And we'll still put up protection fencing and keep it there.
It just happens that sometimes construction gets carried away. And the next thing we know, we have no trees. And we don't want to hold up C of O's when we get down to the very end because we didn't have the landscaping like we thought we were going to have.
And obviously, if there is somehow something happens and it gets removed, then it will be planted back with the appropriate screening methods that's required. So.
And I'm not doubting you, but I'm telling you contractors get carried away sometimes and it's hard to keep all that together. Okay.
Do we have any comments from the audience? This is a motion subject to staff comments.
Motion subject to staff comments and applicant comments.
Motion by Mr. Parker. Second by Mr. Tyler.
Hussein.
Yes.
Mueller.
Yes.
Parker.
Yes.
Tyler.
Yes.
Austin.
Yes.
Cardio.
Yes.
Cloud.
Excuse.
Compton.
Yes.
Couch.
Yes.
That passes 8 with 1 recuse. Next item is L23-19 Cypress Cold Storage, also presented by ESI.
Thank you again. This project was previously approved. Working through final plan, final budgeting, we have reduced the warehouse square footage by approximately 10%. It was basically taken from the west side. We shrunk it down by about 10%. Other than that, same plan. I think we added a phase line for the parking, the trailer parking to the south there. But other than that, I'll answer any questions.
Staff comments?
I did receive some updates this afternoon, but I did not get a chance to review them, so they may have addressed some of my comments. First one, phase two, if not completed within the next year, it will need to come back for further approval. Show the parcel number of the property in a prominent font above the legal description. That was not found. Let's see. Show the typical dimensions of handicap parking. Could not find that on page 3. Show the width of the handicapped access area. That also could not be found with all the stuff that was on the page. Handicap ramp shall be provided wherever a sidewalk crosses a curb, at crosswalks, driveways, and street intersections. Handicap ramps were not found. Please show where they are. Truncated domes are required as per ADA requirements. Show detail of truncated domes. Truncated domes were not found on the plans. On the landscaping plan, showed 72 trees were shown on the landscape plan, but only 37 shown in the legend. Please update. Show size and location of all freestanding signs. Show distances from street right-of-way. Lighting plan is required, displaying at least 1 foot candle of all parking and pedestrian areas. West, north, and east side of the building does not have lighting. Please look at and correct or add measurements for angled parking on this site. Also show what angle the parking spaces are. Previous comments show an informal plat is needed for the two subject parcels that was submitted on February 1st. Please add this information to the covers page for further reference.
Engineering has no further comments.
Do we have any comments from the audience? Okay, This is a motion subject to staff comments.
Motion subject to the many staff comments.
Motion by Dr. Compton.
Second.
Second by Mr. Cloud.
Mueller.
Yes.
Parker.
Yes.
Tyler.
Yes.
Austin.
Yes.
Cardio.
Yes.
Cloud.
Yes.
Compton.
Yes.
Couch.
Yes.
Hussein.
Yes.
That passes 9-0. Next item is L23-20, Elliott Electric Supply Expansion, also presented by ESI.
Thank you. This project was also previously approved. We've modified the parking area in the front of the building along 40th Street. Previously, it had two ponds, the kind of an awkward drive area. Client desires to open up that area for ease of access into the building. And then we've requested a variance of the berm in the back. So there's a 6-foot berm requirement adjacent to residential uses for commercial projects. We are requesting a variance to that standard by providing a 8-foot privacy fence and associated screening trees. I'll answer any questions.
Staff comments?
Besides standard comments and then the one variance that's been asked for, foundation landscaping is required around the building. No, it can't be on the south side of the building, but would need to be on the east and west side of the building. If not handled tonight, a variance will be needed for that.
Engineering has no further comments.
Okay. Does this commission have any questions?
I have a question. What it, this is for my own knowledge. What do we know what the reason that we would have a berm in the code versus a fence? And my question is around all of this paving that's going to happen. Is the berm somehow to mitigate anything other than just the site, or is there a reason why we would do that and go with the fence instead of a berm? Or that's just my question to the staff.
My question is to Jason. Why did you propose a berm to start with?
Well, we've got truck access back there, and so we're trying to, instead of having the truck dock in the front, we've moved the truck dock around to the back. It's the way it was always been planned. We did some movements, some truck turning movements, and it really hinders that action or that movement in the back of the building. I mean, that berm requirement is a 6-foot tall berm. If you go 3-to-1 on those with any sort of top, so say it's 3-to-1 on both sides, that's 18 feet on both sides of that berm. So 36 feet plus, a 4-foot wide top. I mean, you're talking about a 40-foot space back there that's pretty significant on any commercial project, any commercial lot in Springdale, right? If it's adjacent to a residential project or development or existing use. And so,
it's just one of the options that's allowed, and the developer gets to make that.
But I think we talked about this a little bit. I don't know if it's an option or if it's a requirement from the berm side, but I know the screening fence is required along with the trees and the berm. So we're, it's kind of a multi-stage screening factor,
I think it was from shining into the back of those houses. Okay. Because you guys have docks back there, and their headlights are going to be facing toward those.
I think one of the comments,
berm didn't get a lot of discussion. Normally we just don't hear about the berm. So I just,
normally it seems like it's been an option, an optional requirement for screening. Mm-hmm. And that's why you haven't seen it, is because in the past, it's not been a requirement. And so I believe there's been an interpretation that it is required. And so you may see a lot more variance requests for the berm because it's a significant distance off the property line, especially when you're talking about just normal commercial lots in Springdale. But, the only comment that I heard from Ben whenever we met with Patsy about it was that it was placed in the commercial design standards for a sound barrier instead of just a visual barrier. So it was visual and sound.
Yeah.
You know, so, but, I mean, it does impact a lot of properties, a lot of sites in a significant way.
And I would assume that probably most of the traffic that they would get from trucks is going to be during business, normal business hours, right? So it's not like a pilot station or something where you have big trucks kind of coming all.
And we're not talking about a bunch of trucks, you know, every day. I mean, we're talking about a handful a day, right?
Yeah, supplier to deliveries and stuff. Okay, I just wanted to make sure.
So are you proposing trees and a fence on the back? Is that where?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
There is cases where you would have a warehouse that would have 24-hour service and have trucks in and out a lot.
I don't think there's any problem with keeping the berm as a requirement. If we can, you know, if they're going to, if we feel like they're going to comply, we can waive it. It hadn't come up a lot, you know.
No, it hasn't.
This is my question. Okay. Thanks, Jason.
Okay, we can do we want to take the variances together?
Yes.
Sure.
Okay, that's a call for the vote. Call for the vote by Mr. Cardiel.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes. That passes 9-0. Next is the large scale, which is a motion subject to staff comments.
So motion.
Motion by Mr. Cloud.
Second.
Second by Mr. Payton.
Yes.
Parker.
Mr.
Payton.
Yeah, I like it, yeah.
Tyler.
Yes.
Austin.
Yes.
Cardiel.
Yes.
Cloud.
Yes.
Compton.
Yes.
Couch.
Yes.
Hussein.
Yes.
Mueller.
Yes.
Parker.
Yes.
Passes 9-0.
Thank you.
Next is L23-21. Springdale Water Utilities Western Corridor Storage Tank, presented by Caleb LeBeau.
Yes, Caleb LeBeau with Olson. And just to jump into this quickly, so it's a 3 million gallon water tank, associated drive and paving, and an additional landscaping as required. But there were two points on the memo, 9 and 10, that there were potentially to be variances requested for the April meeting for existing sidewalk there just to the northwest of the site, as well as fencing and screening around the site. Both of those are going to be cut. After further discussion with staff, planning, and SWU, that will be met directly per city code, as well as to meet the some of the comments from the setting. So. Effectively,
do we have any staff comments?
So in addition to standard comments, frontage and perimeter landscaping is required in accordance with Chapter 56. A variance has been requested, Project B23-28. The sidewalk at the cul-de-sac of Clark Avenue is required to be 5 feet, and the applicant has agreed to meet that requirement. And a screening fence is required in accordance with Chapter 56, and the applicant has agreed to meet that requirement.
So the plan will have to be modified to include those before we can get
engineering only has standard comments.
Okay. The modification would be slight. We are actually already showing a fence on the property. It was the 6-foot standard barbed wire fence per SWU's detail. So the actual change is relatively very minimal. It would literally be almost just a detail. So.
Okay, but we need the detail.
Okay, gotcha.
We do the details.
Do we have any comments from the audience? Okay, this is a motion subject to staff comments.
What's the height of this thing? I just wondered. I couldn't find it.
130 feet, approximately.
Is the cell tower staying or is it going? Do you know?
Cell tower is not on this property. It's actually on the church property. It's to the...
So, yes? Or as far as you know?
It's not the... So you can see it on this picture. Mm-hmm. The cross that's there, that's a cell tower.
Oh, yeah.
underneath those numbers.
Do we have a motion? Motion by Mr. Tyler.
Second.
Second by Dr. Compton.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
That passes 9-0. Next item is L23-22, Dr. Roller Hanger, presented by ESI.
Thank you, Jason Apple with ESI. Modification to this approved plan, we removed the office area that was on the southeast corner of this hangar, and that was the extent of the modification. And I'll answer any questions.
Staff comments.
Planning staff has only standard comments.
Engineering's only comment is about the multi-use path out front, and we just need a determination as to by whom and when will this trail be built.
Do we have any comments from the audience?
I think that comment about the trail has to be addressed by the Airport Commission. Yeah, and we are working on design standards for the airport, and time permitting, we'll have that soon. Not going as fast as I expected it to, but well, there just doesn't seem as much time to do those kind of things as there used to be. Jason, the size of the actual hangar itself didn't change.
Correct. It just there was a little appendage that was out there. It was about 540 square feet.
Yeah.
That was just off the southeast corner of the hangar there.
Yeah. It was a two-story little piece on that end, yeah. And you took all that off. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, and we are meeting the standard, I believe, on the design standard on the facade that faces.
Which was approved when we put the first hangar in, and this is had to go with this one when the second went in, and they're meeting all those standards. But we're going to try to work on all this other and get it a little bit simpler as we move forward, or a little bit more complicated, you know.
This is a motion subject to staff comments. Motion by Mr. Parker.
Second.
Who was that?
Mr. Austin.
The second by Mr. Austin.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Passes 9-0. Patsy, did I miss the...
Did we miss the variance on the water tower? Is there still one? Yeah. We need to go back. Sorry, I wasn't thinking about it either. When you said you're taking those others off.
Yeah, I crossed it out.
Yeah, I wasn't paying attention either. The variance you're asking for is what?
It is just for screening along the front entryway and then around the paved section. Yeah, sorry, better way to say it, yes.
Okay. You got an existing tree to remain in place. You're not taking that one out, right?
Correct. There's two there on the north side and one on the south.
Okay. Okay. This is a call for the vote.
Call for the vote, Shannon.
Call for the vote by Dr. Compton.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin? Cardiel?
Yes.
That passes 9-0. Next item is B23-25, Karen Frulinger, presented by Karen Frulinger. Can you tell us just a little bit about what you want to do?
Okay.
You may need to pull the mic down so we can hear you.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this is just about a change to the fence, making part of it 8 foot due to the surrounding changes in zoning of the properties to commercial and multifamily. And I'm already having issues with lights. And then there'll be car lights and such from the property come behind me as well, you know, parking lot views. So I'm hoping to minimize some of this. And the property behind me to the north there, I know they've received a variance, and as there's pipes in the ground. So I don't know that they're putting any kind of fencing. I do know that the only landscaping they're doing is a row of crepe myrtles, which are barren most of the year. So I don't know how much an 8 foot fence is going to help, but it should some.
Do we have any staff comments? This is a call for the vote.
Which section of the fence are we talking about bringing up to 8 foot? Are you wanting to take the whole thing?
No, no. Okay. Just on the back, which is the north side, and then the east side, which is faces Oak Grove.
Gotcha. Not the south side, not the street frontage side, but more around here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Parts that are okay. Facing out.
Well, all we advertised for was those two sides. And
yeah, I wanted to be consistent with the neighborhood, you know, on those other sections, so.
And I don't think there's any site distances with the street because you really had two lots and you built on one lot and you have the extra lot as open space or what you got fenced in. So we look to see that when you put fences on the corners by streets, you don't create a site problem when you pull up to the street.
Oh, yeah, it's back quite a bit.
Because it's back far enough, I don't see that as being an issue.
Yes, that's not going to be, shouldn't be an issue at all.
Right.
And I know that I read the thing, and I know we've gone out twice, and we've looked at those lights, and I don't want to second guess this, but the picture that came with the packet, like that picture, those lights seem really bright. Like you can see it's illuminating the house to the north just from the picture. And I'm not second guessing our folks going out, but did they go out at night? I'm assuming they did.
But the lighting issues are only going to increase.
You know, picture is 1,000 words kind of thing. And I just want to make sure that I drove out there today. And from where her house is situated, and I looked and I see the guards on the lights. They seem to.
No, they're not, because the way they are, the lights kind of angle.
Well,
and
I did this from the road. I didn't get up that close.
See,
they do have guards.
Angle out like this, but the light itself is sitting like this. It's not back in, so it's not guarding it.
But like
at all,
we design these things so that even the adjacent property owner doesn't have light infiltration, and you are completely across the street to the corner. So I just, are we, you know, I don't know. I hate asking, are we 100% sure, but
I'm not sure. So I went out there as well, Peyton, and the lights on the storage portion are not full cutoff. The lights in the office portion are. So
these lights in this picture are from the storage.
Correct. Those are not full cutoff. Unfortunately,
you can see the street light, and so I understand that one of the issues is the street light, but there's also four other lights I can see in this picture that are not the street light. So I have a hard time. I don't know. Again, I don't want to, you know, I don't want to cause any issues here, but I just kind of have a hard time believing that there's not any light bleed over.
Well, we can go back and look at their approved plan and see what was approved and see what's out there. This was back in 18 when, and then we had COVID years and we didn't get as much inspection. We'll go back out and look at it and see what it looks like. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, this is a call for the vote.
Call for the vote.
Call for the vote by Mr. Parker.
Compton.
Yes.
Couch.
Yes.
Hussein.
Yes.
Mueller.
Yes.
Parker.
Yes.
Tyler.
Yes.
Austin.
Yes.
Cardio.
Yes.
Cloud.
Yes.
That passes 9-0. Next item is B23-26, Christian Olvera, presented by Alondra Castaneda.
Hello, I am Alondra Castaneda. I am representing myself and my husband, Christian Olvera. We are wanting to increase the fence in front of our house from 3 feet to 5 feet. The reason for this is because we have a busy road in front of our house, and we have a 7-year-old and a baby on the way, and hopefully more children in the future. And we don't think a 3-foot fence is secure enough to keep our children safe. And it just... it concerns me having them play outside, and we just don't feel safe enough. On top of that, we have mailboxes in front of our property, which allows strangers to drive close to our property, which again concerns us with our children. And we have also had multiple break-ins, even with the 3-foot fence in place. We were not living there at the time. We're currently remodeling the house. And since we've been remodeling the house, we have had about 6 break-ins within 8 months. We have made police reports, but unfortunately, they keep coming back. We've set up cameras, and that does not seem to stop them. Hopefully, when we move in, when the house is ready and we move in, that will stop them from coming onto our property. But the sole purpose of wanting to increase our fence is just to have a safe and secure home for our family.
Any comments from the audience?
I have a question. Okay. And is there two major water lines along that area?
They are, but I'm pretty sure they're underneath all the road, but I would make sure.
Okay, because you can't put the fence on top of major water lines through there.
The big one going to Fayetteville.
Okay.
It's still 136 inch, I believe.
Yeah. And you say you would put it back 20 feet. Is that from the edge of the pavement? Is that from your property line? Where is that 20 feet?
The 20 feet start from de la calle, ¿verdad? De la calle. Sí. The 20 feet is going to start from the road.
Okay. So we need to get back and make sure that you're off of that easement before you can put the fence up there if it's approved. Because you don't want to fence it on top of that water line because, well, number one, they won't let you do that. And if they ever had a problem with it, they'd come take your fence out and wouldn't have to put it back. So we need to make sure you get it back far enough that it's not on top of that water line because that's a major distribution line.
¿Cuál es la water line?
And I don't see anything on here. Is there a power line along there? And are you outside the power line? The survey doesn't have a lot of detail on it.
Yeah,
because it says subject to the right-of-way of OR Road and subject to any and all other rights-of-way and easements of record, but it doesn't show us what the other easements of record are.
You definitely want to make sure that you're just far enough back that you're outside of the easement so that you don't have to... Mm-hmm. If they do ever have to get in there and do work and take your fence out, that, you know, it's not going to be a problem. So you just want to make sure that it's 20 feet from the road might not be far enough. You might need to be more than that.
Dijeron que no estemos arriba de las agua y gas, lo que está allí. That's no problem. There's about 100 feet in front of our house. So we have a lot to work with, and we have no problem with putting it further back.
We just want to verify for you where you're going to put it. Katie, is that something you guys can look up the easements and meet out there and help them work out the right location for it? Because we don't want you to put it in. whether you put a 3-foot or a 5-foot, we don't want you to put it in the right plot, in the wrong place. Okay?
Do you have it marked out now? The fence?
Now we're going to just decide whether y'all are going to let it go from 3 to 5.
Yes.
I'm going to tell him come do the fence at my house.
Before you make a comment.
Comments from the commission.
Okay, thank you.
I personally don't think that a 5-foot, normally I probably wouldn't go for this, but I don't think a 5-foot fence is going to be any kind of issue on Old Wire Road, especially on that section. So I don't know that I'd approve this in a subdivision, but I'm okay voting for it. Where you guys at?
Are the gates automatic opening? To open your driveway?
Yes, so I have sketched out how we want the front of the fence to look like. So it's going to be 2 automatic gates. They're going to be 20 feet wide, and they're going to be automatic. I already spoke with some companies who work on automatic gates. And so they said that for emergency services, the automatic gates come with, like, a red box that if, you know, a police car, you know, their sirens, it'll automatically open for them. They also have they put a manual box on there. In case power goes out, we can manually open the gates.
Are you having those open toward the house?
Yes.
Okay. I'm just thinking of stacking when you're coming off, you know, the main highway there, you want to get off as soon as you can. And we'll make sure you have clear if there's 2 or 3 people coming. If the fence is open to the house, it gives you a little bit more, makes that easier. That's what I was asking.
Yes.
Well, and Katie, when you go look at it, you need to make sure that there's enough stacking room that we don't back up.
Yeah.
Yeah. And if they stay off the easement, it's probably going to be 25 feet off of the edge of the right of way, and that may be quite a ways into it when we get all that taken care of.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, this is a call for the vote.
Call for the vote.
Call for the vote by Mr. Parker.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Passes 9-0.
You need to contact the engineering department to work out the location of the fence.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Next item is B23-27, Rick and Nina Chase, presented by Rick and Nina Chase.
Hi, I'm Nina Chase.
Could you tell us a little bit about what you're...
Yes, I'm... making a RV pad for my RV, and it's a gravel just to protect the yard from getting muddy or whatever, and they said that that wasn't supposed to be gravel, so I'm asking for variance for the gravel to remain. It's gravel and cement mixture, so it's compacted.
SB2.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. So I'm asking if would that be a variance for the gravel to remain as is?
Okay.
Katie, you want to talk about how it's put in there?
So typically we require driveway expansions or, driveway kind of takeoffs like this to be paved in the same surface that the existing driveway is. So this one will be required to be concrete. We typically require that to the fence line. And then whatever they do in the backyard, we're not as concerned about. That typically is code enforcement and building. So we would typically require them to come in to the office and submit an application showing us where they want to pave, make sure it doesn't go over 40% of the front yard, that it's not more than or less than 3 feet from the property line. If this was paved in concrete, it would meet the standards. The only problem is that it is shown in gravel currently. So typically the option would be either to remove the gravel and replace it with concrete or for the variance to pass and it remain as is.
Did you look at the option of creating an access off of the back side of your lot to just put it in from the back off of Westwood Lane rather than driving around the side of the house?
There's a curb there, so
well, there wouldn't be. Well, you ask for a curb cut on that side and put one in on that side.
Mm-hmm. No, I don't think that.
Okay.
I mean, basically, we're not going to really be parking on the front, a car really on that gravel area, so the front part.
We appreciate you telling us that, but once it's gravel, it usually gets parked on.
Especially if you don't live there anymore.
Yeah.
That's what I'm usually concerned about, is not necessarily the person that's there today, but you sell and move.
So the issue... The issue is that it doesn't match.
It's not concrete. We don't use gravel. Yeah.
So if she were to asphalt over that SB2, that wouldn't match either, so that wouldn't be acceptable.
No. Are you saying that would not be allowable?
The way it's written currently, the expanded driveway is supposed to be the same material as the existing driveway. So in this case, it would need to be concrete.
Is there any way to make this conditional use or no?
Well, it's not a conditional use. It's just a variance as to whether or not it can be.
Yeah, no, but I want it to go with the people, not the house. So if the people move out, and that means we can go back and look at it again. But
that's complicated. It's a conditional use in the ordinance. No, sorry.
But the variance could be for asphalt instead of, am I correct? You could change your variance over to just pouring asphalt on top of that, as opposed to concrete and making it match. If you do that, I would be more inclined to vote for, gravel's just not, it washes away. It's just not a super great, even if it's SB2, it's not a great long-term thing. But I think I would probably be willing to vote for it if you just wanted to asphalt it. We just usually, I haven't seen us approve a lot of these where they're gravel.
So your current request was for paving requirement. Do you want the Planning Commission to vote on your request to keep it at gravel, or do you want to amend your request?
I think she'd like to amend the request to asphalt over that SB2. Yeah.
Okay.
We should calculate to make sure the 40% is
the thought. Yeah, and engineering would have to verify. I think you're pretty.
Katie said if it would concrete, it'd be okay.
Yep. So you're amending your variance request for a paving requirement to not be concrete, to be asphalt, correct?
Correct.
Okay,
this would be a call for the vote.
Call for the vote.
Call for the vote by Mr. Parker.
Hussein?
Yes.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin?
Yes.
Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
That passes 9-0.
Thank you.
Okay, the next item is L32-18, the after school program gymnasium.
You skipped the Cornelia.
Yes. Oh, whoops.
Yeah.
It
was not the reason. Yeah, because it, sorry.
Okay. B23-29, Cornelia P. Williamson Revocable Trust and Arliss D. and Cornelia P. Williamson, presented by ESI.
Thank you. We kind of have a non-typical variance request tonight. Typically, these fall with or kind of go concurrently with the development plans. My client's, working on budgeting and, working through the cost implications of doing the development and also purchase price and everything goes into development, doing their due diligence with this piece of property. The request tonight is to allow a True Grid product, which is like a gravel pave, or True Grid is a equal product potentially for a paving requirement in the city of Springdale. So this is it's going to be for a trailer storage yard. This product has a kind of honeycomb pattern that's infilled with gravel. It's used in other areas of the United States. These pictures that are going through are of the parking area at the Matrix Tennis Facility in Lowell. New facility, I don't know if anybody's been there, just kind of north of the Harps on Goat Springs up there. And so we're just, you know, really wanting to give an alternative to paving requirements. So this is 100% permeable. We will basically house the detention for this space under the permeable paver, so it reduces the detention footprint, but we're also still accounting for the runoff from the parking lot. There are options to stripe this with little inserts. I think you can see on some of those pictures. Really just, you know, looking for some input and, you know, potentially a vote to allow this. Now, we don't have a totally developed site plan yet. We're potentially looking at 2 to 3 acres of storage that would be paved with this this True Grid material. So I'll answer any questions.
Well, I'm not an engineer to start with, and I think engineering could address that issue. It's just unusual to ask for a variance for an area of a project. We haven't seen the project. We don't know how big the building is. We don't know how it lays out on there. There's a drawing there, and I assume you're going to get close to that. Does engineering have any problems with this product?
So the product itself, the concept itself, we have no issue with. I think we just need more information on this one before we can really, you know, just know what we're getting. So, like, for example, I didn't know how big of an area we were looking to use this product on. Jason just said 2 to 3 acres, but I didn't see any conceptual layout. I didn't see anything like that submitted to know how that was going to work. You know, if they're going to use it as detention, I wasn't sure if that was going to be part of it, with whether it's just there or whether it's used as mitigation for stormwater. You know, I just need a little bit more information before I feel confident on this one.
But you're asking for a variance to allow this product to happen, even though we don't have the details, correct, Jason?
We provided the manufacturer specifications for the product. It was in our letter talking about the True Grid product. It specifies all the requirements, all of the subgrade requirements, all of the backfill requirements that are required with that product. So,
no. Katie, is there any reason to think if they can't meet all of those that we wouldn't want to allow it to happen? I mean, we're putting the Planning Commission, I think, in a bad position to ask you to grant a variance before you really know whether engineering is going to approve it or not, or if it's going to work.
I've seen this product. I've actually had it on projects I've done in the past, not at this scale. I didn't realize you could do it for large vehicles. Most of the time it's for parking spaces. There's a great application in Little Rock at the, just went blank on what it was, people that give goats away. No, I can't think of it. But anyway, so.
International.
There you go, Heifer International. So I love the idea of pervious paving. Do you know what the aggregate they plan on using, Jason? Or they haven't got that far along?
No, I don't know if we have that. I mean, you can see that in those pictures, there's a close-up. It's a well-graded material.
Yeah.
I know it can't be like SB2 where it has a bunch
no,
of
it has
lines
to be able,
in it.
Yeah,
right?
It's
got to be able to permeate into the surface.
Well, so usually I've seen like a sand base, and then there's a mixture of small
sure,
pebbles
yeah,
and stuff.
There's a profile that we're going to have to meet.
My only concern is, do we have a way to verify that it's installed correctly and is working correctly?
We don't even know how big.
Well, I know that, but I don't know that that matters. Well, I mean, it does, but I mean, if I'm more worried about us being able to understand if it's installed correctly and it's working correctly more than anything else.
Well, that's engineering's responsibility.
I know.
I think we can
right, and if they're designing this to handle stormwater, then we would require engineer certifications at the end of the project. We would have inspectors on site, you know, watching it be installed. I don't think we have any issues with the product itself, the concept of it. It's just more the question of how it fits in with the entire development. What is the development? Those kinds of things.
Jason, are you? Is it basically, is your client asking for this because he's thinking this may be a less expensive way? Not overall, just doing this versus all the other things they have to do? Is that one of the reasons he's looking at it?
Also, you know, it's not just an expense thing. It's also a land use and land application. I mean, if we can reduce the footprint of our detention areas for the frontage by utilizing the detention space underneath the permeable section. You know, that helps us be able to, you know, maybe, because this, the way that the project falls, it's going to fall to kind of the north and the west. And so if we can reduce the footprint of that drainage area by utilizing this product, that just helps us get closer to the highway, use more of the property.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it's really less expensive than actually paving something, because the paving requirements, we could put down 2 inches of asphalt meets the requirement. Now, if it holds up, you know, that's, you know, this is a durable product. And, you know, you talked about use before. You know, there's different sections of this stuff. You know, you can use a smaller profile of it for more residential applications. And, you know, if you know, it's just like designing a pavement section. I mean, some of that, it may be a thicker section on the profile of the product for this use. And so, I mean, obviously, we're asking for this variance without a lot of, you know, site impacts. Really, you know, wanting to get some feedback if the product is generally accepted, right, so that we're comfortable moving forward.
So, you're just wanting a temperature if we're open to it. And I think Patsy's right. I don't think there's any way we could, personally, I don't think there's any way I could vote on it based on what we have. But am I open to it? Yeah, anything that leads to less stormwater in Northwest Arkansas is a great idea.
So I think you've got the support of all of us to do it, but you're asking us to do something without knowing all the details to grant a variance, and that puts the Planning Commission in a really bad position.
If it's a good product, we should make it allowable all the time and just do it that way instead of going the variance route.
So I've seen this.
Help us create a new standard that we can add to use for something else.
Sure. I mean, yeah, this is an allowable product. If we can get with engineering and get this to be an allowable product and not have to ask for variance, that's even better.
Well, I don't know that we can do it without a variance, without them looking at it and know that yet.
Well, sure. If that gives us time to evaluate that, get with engineering, move that forward.
So what I'm hearing is you're going to table this and talk to engineering, right?
Yes.
Okay. Good decision.
Hopefully we can get that.
Just for thought real quick. So I've seen a similar product being placed on bike trails, walking trails, and it was a different elevation. It didn't quite work out very well. So just.
There are some challenges in a few places like that.
Yeah, I mean, it's got to be fairly flat, right? Yep. I mean, it can't be, you know, maneuver. I mean, right. I see a lot. You also see some of these types of products in, like, downtown areas. I know in downtown Bentonville around their areas, they've got parking that's with like a more of a pea gravel, but it still has this, you know, honeycomb type profile of support structural value. So anyway, that's what we're after.
Okay.
I'll just say I think it's great to see a little bit more creativity when it does come to some of the stormwater requirements. We don't see things like this. So if you can get past the fact that it's gravel and it can, you know, mitigate our stormwater and decrease impervious surface, it's maybe a great product to, you know, see what other applications we can use it for. Technically it's considered a low impact development. I think the issue with Springdale has been with the gravel. So I think that's the point that y'all have to get past.
Well, you let us know what you find out, Katie. When you
get into it. And it also,
they use a lot for like overflow parking at, you know, like what parks, you know, sports places, when you have that gravel lot, that's where I've seen it too.
But it's also, you know, what I think the reason that gravel is not accepted is it gets dry and it gets dusty, right? And that's a problem. With this material, it's a graded material and it doesn't have those fines that create that dust too. So, I mean, I think all in all, we could probably work with engineering, get it as an approved product prior to submitting the development plans.
Sounds good, thank you.
Okay, L22-18, the after school program gymnasium expansion extension, presented by ESI.
Jason Apple again, here just requesting an extension for this large scale. Just working through final details, really looking to get started in the summer. So.
We're asking for a 1-year extension, but they're probably not going to take that long.
Correct.
But that way we don't have to come back again in 6 months if something happens. So.
Yes.
And it hasn't been extended before. So we need a motion to approve the extension for 1 year.
So moved.
Motion by Dr. Compton. Second by Mr. Tyler.
Mueller?
Yes.
Parker?
Yes.
Tyler?
Yes.
Austin? Cardiel?
Yes.
Cloud?
Yes.
Compton?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hussein?
Yes.
Passes 9-0.
Thank you.
My turn?
Yes.
I have to say that I will give you a double report next time. We rolled out a new website Monday, and not everything got transferred over with it, and so I haven't been able to get to agendas in time to be able to do that, so I'll do both of them next time. The question that we have is, this month's work session is during spring break. And are we going to have enough people here to work, to have a work session during spring break? Okay, I'm assuming a lot of people are going to be gone. Do we have anybody who's going to be here during spring break?
I'll be here the first part.
Okay, we got
spring break. Spring break.
So I would suggest that we just table, not have a work session this month, and we'll pick one up in April and start moving forward as quickly as we can. Okay, does that work for everybody?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I don't have anything else.
Okay, we're adjourned.